the elderly and the middle-aged people. Now there is a shift in the age pattern compared to previous last year's disease. Now it is more towards the younger generation also. Even younger generation are also having a severe illness compared to the last year, and even we have seen some more mortalities even in the younger generation also. And what is more worrisome is even it is affecting the people who are having a very good immunity. That is the reason why the new variants are also being seen. It is also you are also able to see the infection in already patients who have been already people who have been vaccinated, and there is also reinfection in already patients who have been infected and now they are free from the COVID. So when you will call the reinfected case means like a person who is COVID positive, after that 3 months he is not having any symptoms and he is RT-PCR is negative. After 3 months, if he is again tested positive, then it is called as a reinfection according to the recent guidelines. So what is new compared to the previous strain? See, in 2020, everyone thought mostly COVID you will be seeing in the cold areas, cold climatic seasons. You'll not be seeing in hot climatic seasons. But this is all like is proved as wrong. Like there is no seasonal variation, and surface transmission of virus is there. But now compared to previous strain, that is not no more a threat. Comparatively, now newer strain airborne is also there. But some are contradicting it, some are like airborne transmission is there. Recently, one article is being published in the guy in the Lancet. It was showing almost there is a 10 possible reasons to tell that there is an airborne transmission. One of which is what they have observed is people now because of the lack of hospital beds and all, now mild cases are being treated in the hospital. In hotels also. So they have observed that a patient, one patient in one room and the other patient in the other room, they are like who is asymptomatic, is not having a disease, they are also getting positive after a few days. And they have observed more number of cases in the indoor people, like those who are staying in the indoors, closed areas, in those people, those closed areas, they have observed more disease compared to previous one. Likewise, they have given almost 10 reasons telling that there is an airborne transmission in the current variants. And what is different and what is different from the previous strain is like now it is affecting a younger generation more. It is also affecting the those who are more immune, having a more immunity response compared to before, and it is also affecting a even higher socioeconomic status people also. So, and there is a condition where even RT-PCR also into the present strain, we are getting a negative, even then there is a disease. Previously, these many negatives were there, not there. If you are doing a previously RT-PCR was considered as a gold standard. Now also it is a gold standard. There is no doubt, but compared to the previous last year, now we have seen more negatives in the RT-PCR. Maybe because most of the labs they are whenever they are doing the test, they are only seeing one or two genes. They are ignoring some S gene. If they are seeing ORB gene and N gene, is they are ignoring S gene. They are considering if even if S gene is not detectable, they are considering it as a negative only. So that may be the reason for the more negatives in the present scenario. Because why S gene is very important is whenever the disease is entering into our body, like into the nasal area or anywhere, it goes into the ciliated cells. From there, because ciliated cells, it will be having a movement, so it will go into the lungs. From there, where it start expressing is the S gene is where it is very important, where it will go and join there. So S gene is also important for the detection of the virus. So coming to signs and symptoms, COVID or COVID-19 is, it is not only a lung disease, it is a systemic thrombo hyperinflammatory vascular disease. Why I am telling this is everyone is in impression that it is only a lung, most of the people oxygen saturation decreasing, but beyond lung there are so many other complications happening in the COVID-19. Like most dreadful complication is thrombosis of the major vessels, minor vessels. So they are prone to ischemia, that is myocardial infarctions, strokes, and even the major vessels are also getting blocked because of the COVID disease. So what is more important in this current new disease, new strain disease, is the time. Time will decide what exactly, like how vigilant you are. That all depends upon the time. See, what is more important is whenever a patient or anyone, what they have to recognize is when they are start feeling unwell for the first time. That is, they need to find out what is the first day of the illness. That is more important. Why it is more important is first day of the, even if you are having a symptom on day one, before that also you are transmitting the disease. That is, asymptomatic transmission is also there. So, and in current strain compared to the previous strains, it is more virulent for the initial 5 to 7 days. So compared to previous last year's strain, it is having incubation period of up to 10 to 14 days. Now we are almost seeing after 9 days, disease is not replicating that much compared to the previous disease. So what is more important is what is your first day of illness, when you have started feeling unwell. So that is the time it is all dependent. Treatment and everything is dependent upon when you are starting.
Hema, I think you are on mute, Hema. By mistakenly, some student have muted you, I think, Hema.
Yes.
Yes. Sir, Hema, yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Someone able has muted yourself by mistake, Ma.
You are able to hear me right now?
Good session which we were discussing, suddenly someone muted. No problem. We can continue.
Yes, sir.
Able to hear me right now?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. So after the first day, like initial 2 to 3 days, it is very important because this is the phase where the virus is start replicating. So when virus is start replicating, it will be showing the symptoms like fever or some myalgia, something like that. But whenever viruses start replicating, even our body also, what it will do, because of the innate immunity which is we are having, it start fighting against the virus. So that is the first line of defense. By first line, second line, macrophages and everything, it will start fighting with the disease. Then after that, this is the very crucial phase where everyone will be having so many doubts regarding remdesivir and all. Remdesivir, this is a RNA polymerase that is RNP dependent, that antiviral agent. So these antivirals and all will be effective only during these highly replicating phase. Anyone using remdesivir after 9 to 10 days, whether it is useful or no, there is no consensus. In these initial replicating phases only, remdesivir is very useful. And after first week, then when you are entering into the second week, if you are controlled symptoms by first week, it is well and good. Once the disease is entering into the second week, then your immune-mediated inflammatory response will be started. Once it starts, it will be showing a symptoms like very high grade fever. Initially, you will be having first 1 or 2 days, you'll be having fever. After that, fever will be subsided. Then suddenly again, once you enter into the seventh or eighth day, you'll start again having a very high temperatures. That is a not good sign. And you started feeling breathlessness. That is also not good sign. If you are not catching these things, then this inflammation will go into hyperinflammation, then it will land up in cytochrome storm. Why deaths are happening, why morbidity is happening, is people are ignoring these alarming signs and all. So that's why mortality and all is happening. And I can't say previous variant was like that, but now new variant, even that is also not predictable. Some people, they are having high disease, but they are recovering well. Some people, it is very unpredictable, maybe because it is very early to tell also, but it is very unpredictable compared to the previous. So on day one, like what are the usual symptoms you'll be having? Usually a fever, a low grade fever, a mild cough, myalgias, loss of smell, loss of taste, and the happy hypoxia. See, you may be hearing what is happy hypoxia. See, happy hypoxia is nothing but young individual or any individual who had a disease will be having an hypoxia, but it will not, you'll not be showing any symptoms. They'll be asymptomatic, but suddenly when they started feeling like more of how we will be knowing it, like whenever you are having a pulse oximeter, anything, if you put it in your finger, definitely it will be any patient who is having an hypoxia, there will be a sign of increased heart rate will be more than 100, and you will feel tachypneic. So if they are able to catch that one, then happy hypoxia, then we can tell that happy hypoxia is there, but you can catch because based on this heart rate and tachypnea, more respiratory rate. And even you start breathing very deep breaths, and rate will be more deep breaths, so respiratory pattern also will be changed. Even very mild symptom like hand grip, like you'll be having a very low hand grip, that is also one of the signs. So why I said systemic, it is not only a lung disease, because it is influencing so many systems. Like you'll be having a headache. So this is one of the tabular column from the Lancet journal, which is showing, if you are able to see almost every organ, it is completely like it is infecting. Brain, kidney, liver, GIT, you may show symptoms of diarrhea, some people may show symptoms of elevated liver enzymes, some may show elevated creatinine. So even skin rashes, or suddenly a diabetic patient is having uncontrolled sugars, that is also one of the same. So along with this one, you may see certain signs which you will be missing. So what is very important in this current period is like time. When you are recognizing the first symptom, or when you are recognizing the initial symptoms, once you recognize it, you need to go to hospital, or you need to contact any doctor through telephone or something, or do a test, then if you are positive, then you need to contact, or like home isolation. There are so many, depending upon your symptoms, so many treatment options are available. So if you are having a symptom, certain symptoms like fever, so what test you have to do? Whether we need to do a RT-PCR, whether we need to do a rapid antigen, whether we have to go to a HRCT. So out of all this, you can do on day one is one CBP count, that where you'll be showing total leukocytes and differential leukocyte count. In this, what is important is whenever a patient is having a COVID, you'll be seeing a neutrophil and a lymphocyte ratio, which is changing. So that is NLR ratio. That is very important in diagnosing the disease, along with the remaining other markers. Like other markers are like CRP. If you are doing in CRP initially, when you are in a replicating phase, then depending upon the number what you are getting, it will be like it is a mild or moderate or severe. When we need to do a HRCT, yes, you can do initially, depending, for example, any patient who is having high fevers on third or fourth day, they have to do HRCT along with the RT-PCR. And anyone who is having a cough, they have to do a HRCT definitely on initial first two days only. And along with that one, depending upon the symptoms, you need to go for the test. What are the tests we need to do is, first is CBP, along with that one, inflammatory markers like CRP you need to do, ferritin you need to do, and ESR and LDH. And patient who is already having some other comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, they need to do all other comorbidities. They need to do renal function test and liver function test along with these tests. Is you may have a doubt, like, is this important to have all these tests done on the day one only? See, it is like that is the, like, when you need to pick up the disease initially, we need to know what is happening inside. One way of knowing it is by clinical symptoms. Clinical symptoms, if you're able to tell properly, if you're able to recognize it, then it is fair enough. You can start the treatment, or you can categorize yourself into the mild, moderate, or depending upon the symptoms. Then you can go for the test. Depending upon the symptoms, what you are having, you can do different types of test. See, lab values, depending on the lab values, you can categorize into mild disease, moderate disease, and severe disease. Anyone who is having an NLR ratio less than 3.5, they are considered to be a mild disease. What I am going to stress in this session is mild and home isolation. Like, this disease I'll be more covering, because any patient, anyone who is having a moderate disease, they definitely has to go to the hospital if they are having certain signs, which I'll be letting you know in next few minutes. So once you are hospitalized, then it is a duty of the doctor. They'll be taking care of you. What is more important for me to educate yourself is when you have to go to the hospital, what are the initial symptoms you need to catch? What are the initial diagnostic features? What are all there we need to catch? So CRP, for example, CRP, if it is less than 20, okay, you're fine. Ferritin, if it is less than 500, that is fine. D-dimer, if it is 500 nanograms, that is fine. Or if it is more than that, then you need to worry. You need to, depending upon the D-dimer value, we need to take blood thinners. Interleukin-6. See, so many, like, previously no one would have been known what is interleukin-6. This interleukin-6 is a good marker, but in current trend, different lab people are giving different values because of how they are doing. So if you are doing the interleukin marker with the same lab, which is already a recognized lab, then we can correlate with that one, until unless it, otherwise it is getting difficult for correlating interleukin also in current disease. And LFT, raised ALK, ALP, enzymes, all enzymes, then definitely it will go into moderate to severe disease. Symptoms, like how you will categorize yourself. For example, if you are seeing, if you are having a pulse oximeter with you, if you are seeing it pulse oximeter, if it is showing anything more than 94, it's okay. You're considered to be having a mild disease. If you take a symptomatic treatment like proper hydration, proper food, for example, if you're having a fever, take antipyretics like Dolo 650. Depending upon the weight, you can have to take the tablet. Any person more than 60, they need to take more dose. It is like 15 milligram per kg body weight per dose. Respiratory rate, for example, if it is less than 24, it is okay, considered to be a mild disease. Fever on and off, that's fine. But 1-2 days, if it is on and off, it's okay. But after 5th or 6th day, if you are having a fever, that is definitely alarming. Excuse me.
Guys, request everyone to be on mute.
CT chest, HRCT. See, HRCT, so many people are seeing, like HRCT, CORADS 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If anyone is telling CORAD 6, that means that your RT-PCR is positive. So whoever RT-PCR is positive, he is considered to be a CORAD 6. Whether his lung involvement is less or more, he is considered to be a CORAD 6. What will tell the severity of the disease is, see, a lungs we have divided into 25, out of which if you are any lung involvement is less than 8 zones, then you are considered to be a mild disease. 8 to 15 considered to be moderate, more than 15 definitely it is a severe disease. And any person whose lung involvement is more than or equals to 12, though initially 3rd day if they are doing HRCT, if it is showing 8 to 10 or 10 to 12 involvement, previously it was not that much worrisome, but what is happening in the last 2-3 months is like, if you redo the HRCT after 1 or 2 days, we are seeing from 8 to almost 16 to 17. That much difference is there, that much rapidly it is progressing. So if you have a symptoms, severe cough and all, even if then definitely if it is even a 10 and all also, you need to revisit your doctor. And along with this one, RT-PCR. RT-PCR is also CT values, what it is showing, that is cycle thresholds. If cycle threshold value is less than 25 or less than 35, now it is 35. If it is less than 35, it is considered to be a positive. If it is more than 35, it is considered to be a negative. Lesser, for example, if the RT-PCR are able to recognize the disease with very few cycles, for example, 8 to 10, lesser the amount of cycles, more severe the viral load. So anyone who is having single digits, definitely they are having a very high viral load. They need to be treated properly. So this RT-PCR, I have already mentioned, see RT-PCR like ORF gene, N gene, some labs, they are ignoring S gene. So we are seeing more of RT-PCR negatives nowadays. So how to diagnose when a patient is having a RT-PCR negative? What is more important during that phase is clinical features. Even if you are RT-PCR negative, if you are a positive, it is a positive. If you are negative, it is not a negative. It is only having some 50 to 60% sensitivity. So what is more important during that time is what are the symptoms you are having. If you have done any other investigations, what it is showing, markers, what it is showing. You are having a fever, then you are asked by the doctor to get a scan done. Then if it is showing involvement more than 8, then at that time, definitely it is, even though it is RT-PCR negative, you are considered to be having a COVID-19 disease. So coming to mild cases, what we need to do? Mild cases, whether to join, go to hospital, whether to admit in the hospital, or we need to take symptomatic treatment. It all depends how vigilant you are. In mild cases, if you are having a teleconsultation or if you have visited a doctor once, you have taken the precautions and all are told by the doctor, all the medications if you are taking, just only symptomatic treatment, like if you are having a fever, take antibiotics. If you are having a cold, take any antihistaminics like levetiracetam with montelukast or anything. If you are having along with these medications, any other medications which is showing, like most of them now they are prescribing azithromycin. So now we have enough consensus that azithromycin is not having any role in controlling the COVID-19 disease with mild symptoms. And because COVID-19, it is not only a lung disease, it is thrombotic complication. They need to be started on blood thinners. It is also very important when to start. For example, if you had a D-dimer done, if it's showing less than 100, then for example, epixaban, epixaban for mg od for 10 days and all, that will prevent the complication. And anyone who is having a D-dimer value more than 500, definitely they need to be on blood thinners, like injectables like low molecular weight heparin or any newer generation.
Srinivas sir, I think your voice is breaking. I don't know, it is only for me or for everyone. Randeep, can you confirm, is this only for me, voice is breaking?
And also for me also, since 10 seconds.
Yeah, I think in middle lightly voice is breaking.
I'm audible
right now. Now it is fine, I think. Now it is fine. Yeah.
Hello.
Sorry, yeah, you're not audible. Yeah, correct.
Maybe because of the net.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now it is audible.
Is it okay right now?
Yep.
Yes, it is audible.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Continuing with the topic, like favipiravir. See, few people are okay with their personal experience and choice. Like there, for few people, it is showing. But what consensus is, what evidence is telling is, there is no use or doubtful role of the favipiravir in mild disease. But it is all up to the patient or up to the doctor who is treating the patient. They can use the favipiravir because being it is an antiviral, can be used. But it is having a doubtful role. Steroids, is it mandatory in the first phase or when we need to use steroids? See, steroids, when we need to use is steroid B to reduce the inflammation. So we, by this time, we know that initial replication phase, it is steroid. Certain times where in not even during that phase. For example, a patient is having a COVID. Which is viral load. It's testing with the pulse oximeter, it is showing 97-98 initially. Before 6 minutes, if his walk saturation is dropping by 5%. For example, if it is 98, it is coming to 93 or 92. Then that is the important sign where we need to start a steroid. Where we have systematic cases less than 7 unit of steroids, any CT score less than 8, no unit of steroids, there is viral dose. If you are using, that is a double S word. For example, if you are using a steroid during the viral phase, what steroid will do is it will lessen our immunity, because whenever we have initially we are facing the virus or antigen, our body will start producing defense mechanism by producing some macrophages, neutrophils. So what steroid will do is it hampers that innate immunity what we are having, which we have developed from the generations. So what is more important is when we have to start the steroids. Steroids, we need to definitely should not be used. Any person who is having mild disease, saturations are more than 97, there is no requirement of oxygen, and during initial 3 to 4 days. Home isolation, like what are all we need to see in home isolation? A patient who is having a mild disease, one, if you people are seeing the screen, just I am showing a pulse oximeter. Even pulse oximeter also, what we have to see, what we have to see is, are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, it is visible.
Yeah, what is more important is the wave pattern which you are seeing. So if the wave pattern is very irregular, even if it is showing a 99, that is not considered to be a correct. If it is showing a uniformity, then if it is showing even 97, that is correct. So what in home isolation, what we have to take care is, we need to see the pulse oximeter with like whether it is showing correctly or wrong, or how we have to differentiate is that wave pattern which is shown in the pulse oximeter, that should be uniform enough. Then you need to consider that value as a correct value. For example, if I change my finger, you can able to see there is a loss of uniformity in that wave pattern. You should not consider that 98 or 97, whichever is showing during that time. So that is more important. And you are in home isolation. So what are all the precautions you need to take? definitely during initial 6 to 7 days, you will be transmitting the disease to everyone, those who are surrounding. So definitely you need to wear a mask. So what mask we need to wear, whether we need to wear a cloth mask or a surgical mask or N95 mask. For example, if you are having a very high cough, then it is better to wear a surgical, not surgical, it is better to wear a N95 mask so that you'll avoid infecting the others. It is okay also if you are wearing a surgical mask with a double mask, like surgical mask with a cloth mask, also that is also okay. So what is more important during the isolation is, you need to pick up the symptoms, alarming signs. One is saturation, your heart rate, your respiratory rate. If you're having a more respiratory rate, definitely that is an alarming sign. And you have a fever 2-3 days before, and again you are starting having a fever after 5 days or 6 days of the treatment. That is also one of the alarming signs. And what we need to do in the home isolation. See how we need to maintain ourselves. Then you need to be very positive, you need to take a very good diet, hydration. Along with that one, you need to do a single breath count test. See how we need to do single breath count test is, you can, while sitting or even if you are walking also, just hold the breath and start counting the numbers like 1, 2, 3. If you are able to hold a breath for more than 15, then it's okay. Even if you are not holding a breath, don't panic yourself. Wait for some time, take relax for half an hour or so, then again start doing it. If you are not able to hold breath during that time, less than 15, if you are not able to count 15 by holding a breath, then just you need to think that there is something wrong which is going in your body. Then that is a sign to meet your doctor. And one more thing, during home isolation, what we need to do, breathing exercises. I'll be dealing with the breathing exercise after. So along with this home isolation, what we need to do is these medications. Along with this one, you need to take a vitamin supplementations. Like for example, now in current generation, almost more than 60% they are vitamin deficient because of the lifestyle modifications. Most of the people are contained to the one room or AC room, not exposed to the sun that much. So due to various reasons, there most of the people are vitamin D deficient. Check the vitamin D deficiency. If you are having a vitamin deficiency, definitely you need to take the medications. Vitamin D 60,000 you need to take for the first 3 days. If your vitamin D values are normal, then once a week supplementation of 60,000 international units is sufficient. Along with that one, vitamin C, which is considered to be increasing, boosting up our immunity. So take vitamin C like 500 to 1 gram depending upon your body weight, twice daily or thrice daily, initial 2 to 3 days. That will not harm you in any way. Along with that one, do gargling with betadine, or if you don't have a betadine, do gargling with salt water, which will soothe your throat and all. And steam inhalation, how important it is. Definitely it is important. For example, if you are having a disease, directly disease will not enter into the lung. It definitely has to go through nasal passages. Maybe during that phase, you may be asymptomatic. So during that, in that people only directly it is affecting lungs. But if it is there only in nasopharynx and oropharynx, you can control the viral load by doing a betadine or salt water gargling with the steam inhalation and exposure to the sun. And what is more important during the home isolation is your room should be very well ventilated. And you should not sit in a closed room. And that doesn't mean that you should roam around. You have to be in the room only, but the ventilation should be proper. And try to clean your hands frequently with the soap or whatever you are having. The objects which you are touching, because you'll be in a viremic phase, definitely you'll be spreading. There is a droplet transmission chance is there. So maybe you'll be touching the objects again, you'll be touching, so reinfection. So to avoid all those things, try washing your hands frequently. And these are all the things you need to take care of in home isolation. So when we need to admit in hospital, see, whenever you are having NLR ratio more than 3.5, if you have done with the lab values raised CRP, ferritin, D-dimer, and eosinophil count is completely zero, during these are all signs where we have to go to doctor. We need to revisit your doctor, telling, even though you are not, definitely if you are having any of these signs, these lab values, definitely you will be having a fever or cough, some or the other symptoms will be there to that person. When we have to be more vigilant, like for example, on fifth day or sixth day, you are having a temperature of more than 101 or 102, even it is not controlled with the paracetamol, or if you are having a cough, a persistent cough for more than 3 days, and suddenly you are feeling breathless, then definitely that is a time you should not waste that time. See, during that time, you should not consider yourself to be a mild disease. You need to get hospitalized during that time. This is the very crucial time where you'll be like, we'll see for three, four days, or like, so depending if you're having a symptoms of like fever more than 3 days, not controlling with the antipyretics or shortness of breath, that is a sign for yourself to get admitted to the hospital. Don't take like, because in current scenario, those who are having these symptoms, if they are controlling by somehow, and if they are taking home medications, or they are isolating themselves, if they are taking, within 2 to 3 days, they are coming back to us with very huge involvement, like more than 15, 16 involvement of the lungs. Previously, it used to be like eight zones like that. Within 1 or 2 days, like almost it is doubling. So these signs, you should not override it. And what are all the current recommendations? Like what medications? Definitely have told you anticoagulation, like blood thinners. If you are having a mild disease, apixaban 2.5 mg. Ivermectin, colchicine, these two drugs, some journals are telling there is no use. There is only conditionally, depending upon the doctors and patient compliance, we can use it. Colchicine, yes, there are so many journals which is showing it is beneficial in the initial mild disease. Initial mild disease means like it is mild to moderate. Those are having RT-PCR, if you are having around 20, like that, and lung involvement around 7, 8, 9. In these people, initial days, if you are using a colchicine, these are all having a good results. So when we need to use remdesivir, because it is an antiviral, you need to use this test. You need to use this drug during 5 to 7 days. It is more effective if you are using before 9 days. In last 2 to 3 months, what we are seeing is after 10th day, we are not seeing a patient is getting deteriorated after that. If he is fine for 10 days, very unlikely a patient is having a severe disease after 10th day. If he is having mild disease for up to 9 to 10 days, until unless he is having other infections, added infections, anything like that, or if he is having any comorbidities which is exacerbated because of the COVID or because of the medications, if he is using any side effects, because depending upon that. And remdesivir, definitely it is having a role if you are using it in a proper time, but it is not a wonder drug. It is only controlling it is not the only drug which is controlling the COVID disease. And steroids along with the remdesivir, definitely it is having a very good role if you are using it in around 7th to 9th day of the disease. If you are using steroids along with the remdesivir, and even recently there is a drug like bortezomib, if you are using along with the remdesivir, there are certain guidelines which is showing if you are using remdesivir along with the bortezomib, there is definitely a good results compared to if you are using only remdesivir. But these drugs have to be used during the replicating, that is viremia phase. If you are using a remdesivir after 10 days, consensus what it is telling is definitely role is like it is a debatable. How to improve your oxygen level during home isolation, breathing exercises, spirometry, diaphragmatic exercise. Breathing exercises, how you will be doing is, if you are sitting on a chair, how you need to do is, you need to hold your opposite lung. Just you need to keep your hand below the opposite lung. Try to breathe for 3 to 4 seconds, then hold it for 3 to 4 minutes. When you are inhale it through nose, hold the opposite lung, inhale it through nose, hold it for 3 to 4 seconds, then slowly try to exhale it through mouth. That is the breathing exercise. If you are doing it, that will help in improving in oxygen. That's what we'll recommend to our patients who are taking, you will be in home isolation. If you want to do more vigorous from this one, what we need to do is, along with holding the opposite lung with your hand, try to raise the opposite hand a bit. Start holding the breath for 3 to 4 seconds and slowly exhale it through mouth. So this definitely will improve your oxygenation. And diaphragmatic exercise. How you need to do diaphragmatic exercise means, why diaphragmatic exercise is important is because a patient who is having a mild to moderate disease definitely will start breathing more. He'll be tachypneic. So once you are tachypneic, diaphragm, it is not uniform muscle. You will be having certain places, you'll be having muscle, certain places it is muscle deficient. So definitely the imbalance, there is a hormonal change in that diaphragmatic movement also. To train your diaphragm, you need to do, just you need to keep your both the hands just below the chest. Inhale through the nose, hold it for 3 to 5 seconds and exhale it through mouth. Try to repeat these things every 2 hours or 4 hours, if it is comfortable for you, then definitely it will be showing a good improvement in your oxygen levels. Along with this one, if you people know about the spirometer, how to do spirometer, I can't tell because I don't have the spirometer right now. But you can go and search in the YouTube how to do the spirometer. Just if you are holding the spirometer, that valve will be there. You have to hold it, completely close the mouth. And after that, you need to inhale it. Once you're inhaling it, definitely there should be a more than 2 balls. You should raise that one. Even it is one, if you are raising a one ball also, no need to worry. Start doing it, then your lungs will get trained. After that, definitely you'll be seeing a improvement in oxygen level. Along with this one, what is more important is proning. Try to sleep in a prone position. Why proning is that important is, definitely because of the gravity, if you are sleeping in the prone position, heart and liver will not be compressing the lung. If it is compressing the lung, that parts will not be ventilating. So you are because of the disease, some part of the lung is already diseased, which is not useful in the oxygenation and ventilation. So definitely you'll be seeing a ventilation and perfusion mismatch. What proning will do is, this definitely will improve the ventilation perfusion mismatch. How we need to do the proning? So if you are seeing, you can see the slide, 30 minutes to 2 hours, you have to lie down on your belly. After that, you need to change your position after 30 minutes to 2 hours, to right lateral, left lateral. Even if you are sitting in a prone supine position, try to raise your bed, try to keep some pillows behind your neck and something like that, and keep yourself propped up position. That definitely will help your oxygenation levels. This is the journal. So many people will be having doubts on vaccination program, like whether to take the vaccine, whether not to take the vaccine. Recently published in Lancet, anti-scientific, if you are able to see this, the anti-scientific, anti-vaccine discourse. Recently, in social media, somewhere, those who are discouraging the vaccine, more likes are like more people are watching, more likes are only to that videos or that post compared to the even consists also showing that anti-vaccine groups on social media have increased their followership base by 7.8 million since 2019. So you can see how against people are. So definitely vaccine, if you are getting some form of vaccine, it is better to take it. Whether it is a Covishield, Comaxin, Sputnik, whatever it is, getting a vaccine, take it. That definitely we have seen lot of even if patient who are vaccinated, if you are getting a reinfection, definitely the disease is milder compared to the people who are not vaccinated. And one more thing, recently there is certain doubt, like double mutants are there, new mutant viruses there, whether if you have taken the vaccine, whether it will be useful or not, whether it is a waste. See, whatever it is, without a vaccine, if a lung is infecting, definitely more than with vaccine. Whether it is a double mutant or a UK strain or some other strain, definitely vaccine will help you in one way or the other way. So if you are getting a chance to get vaccinated, get vaccinated as early as possible. Inhalational methods like steam. If you are having a nebulizer, use nebulization like with normal saline. That definitely will improve your how it will improve your lung mechanics, means because if you'll be breathing a lot, so definitely your mouth, mucosa, everything will get dry after some time. So if you are nebulizing yourself, you are using a steam, that will increase the moisture content of the mucosa of the nasal, oral, and bronchial, and even alveolar level also. So even in the recent journal published in Lancet, there is a definitely improved symptoms if you are using any patient who is already having an asthma, if they are on inhalers, if they are using inhaler, or a patient who is having not on asthma also, if he is having a mild disease, if you are taking any inhaler like nebulization with budesonide, if you are having a more cough or more temperature, definitely there is improvement in the patient symptomatology. If you are using a inhaled nebulization with budesonide or even with a normal saline or normal water also. Post vaccine and post COVID management, how important it is like there are so many studies. Even if a patient who is already diseased, very well, like moderate to severe disease having definitely lung will go into the fibrotic changes, so he may be will be dependent on the oxygen for more period, or some people whose lungs are diseased more, they are going for the lung transplant, and whose lungs are diseased little bit, so there are certain antifibrinolytics because your lung got diseased. Definitely if your lung or anywhere if your body is having a disease, definitely our body try to produce a fibrotic fibrotic receptor because activating the receptor which will be sending the this transforming growth factor, which will be stimulating that one. So what it will be doing is it will be try to heal the disease which has happened. If the disease is more, it is more of generation of this transforming growth factor, so your more healing will be there. So that if that is more than normal, then definitely the lung will go into fibrosis, or any part for that matter, it will go into fibrosis. So if your lung is going into fibrosis, then definitely that part of the lung is not used for ventilation or oxygenation. So that's how. And even yesterday also I have seen one patient who is after post COVID, he is a diabetic, so his sugars levels were very high. Now he is having almost got infected with COVID now 20-25 days. Suddenly he is having symptoms like headache and some eye pain, and some left side, some vision, double vision, something like that. Very you're having some altered sensorium, something like that, and you will started seeing something is discharging from your nose. So what that is all very bad. So that's why we'll ask our patients to come and meet after 20-25 days to have a 1 hour to visit, depending upon the symptoms or anything. Why it is important is this is like if anyone is showing this is these symptoms, it is a very rare symptom, but why what that is called a mucormycosis, which is a fungal infection, because a patient who is having who was taking steroids for a longer period of time, maybe because his immune would have been compromised for a longer period of time. So because immunity has been reduced, definitely fungal, bacterial, definitely they'll start attacking ourselves. This is one of the dreadful symptoms, but it is a curable. If you go to a doctor, if it is diagnosed early enough, as soon as you are diagnosed, they'll remove that fungal thing by surgery. And once that is done, then it can be prevented. So that is the reason why while we'll ask patients to come after the post-COVID management, after a month or so, or 15 to 20 days, why it is important is certain symptoms which is not, which may think the same patient which I was talking about, he was like having a symptoms. So like he is not my patient, but my friend something, he was treated somewhere. Yesterday he called me asking this, actually I'm having like my so-and-so is having these symptoms. So we thought maybe because we are having a headache, we went to neurologist, he told scan, MRI and all, no, there is no improvement. Like when he was like, then definitely depending upon his symptoms, because we have seen some few patients like this who having a mucormycosis in them. So able to tell him to do a CT scan. So today he has done, maybe on Monday or so, he'll be getting operated for the same. So this is a dreadful complication, but if you catch properly, if you're able to catch that one, then it is avoidable. How dreadful it is even there are patients who have lost their eyes because of this mucormycosis. So to conclude, what I can conclude is outpatient treatments for COVID-19 coupled with an effective vaccine, that may be the end for this pandemic. This is the recent wordings from the journal, like American Medical Association journal. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas. It was a super good session. If I reiterate correctly, the last slide says that if we are COVID positive and we have developed the antibodies and then we go for vaccine, it is a good combination. Right?
Definitely.
Okay. So I have to go for vaccination then.
That's what, once you get a chance to get vaccination, like just get it.
Right.
That will help you more than any.